Would you please rise and join me in a call to worship? Listen, O people, God is one, and you shall love your God with all your heart and soul and mind and strength. Listen, O people, the second commandment is like the first. You should love your neighbor as you love yourself. Loving God, our neighbor, and ourselves is more important than anything else.
As we stand before God, this morning we want to remember those who have served the church and been part of our number for years and whom we've lost over the last year. We haven't lost them in the sense that they're not there anymore. God has gained them in the sense that they are in heaven with our Creator. And so we want to remember them and remember their service to this church and their love for us. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to read each name and the day that they passed away, and we'll sound a chime in their memory. And then when we get to the end of that, I'll say a prayer and we'll sing our first hymn. We remember these who are among our number. Gertrude Dickey, who left this life December 20th, 2014. Melvin Nuss passed away January 19, 2015. Hannah Shively, who left this life February 24 of 2015. Naomi Risen, who passed away February 24th of 2015. Lillian Holsapple, who died April 29th, 2015. Kenneth Broadbeck, who left this life May 11th of 2015. Margaret Weedock, who passed away June 27th, 2015. Pansy McFerrin, who died July 4th, 2015. Pauline Donovan, who died July 24th, 2015. LaVon Catter, who passed away August 8th of 2015. Ray Schmidt, who left this life September 11th, 2015. And Howard Dickman, who left this life October 11th of 2015. O Lord our God, creator of all that is and ever was and ever will be, we remember these who are part of our number here, part of our church family. Though we mourn their loss, though we mourn the fact that they are no longer here with us, we do celebrate that they are in heaven with you. And so, God, we bless you for each one of them. We thank you that they have been a part of this church. We thank you for what they've meant to this church and what this church has meant to them. And we ask, God, that as they go on into eternity, that they might find the joy and the peace that they each so deserve. Bless us in this church that we may follow in their footsteps and that we might be mindful of the love that they had for us and of the care that they had for this congregation. Watch over them as they wait for us to join them. We pray in Jesus' holy name. Amen.
Yeah.
Please join me in the prayer of confession. Almighty and everlasting God, always more ready to hear than we are to pray, always willing to give more than we either desire or deserve, pour out upon us the abundance of your mercy, forgiving those things of which our conscience is afraid, and giving us those good things which we are not worthy to ask, except through the merits and mediation of Jesus Christ, your begotten one, our Savior. Amen. Surely. The peace of God be with you. Wish one another a good morning. Go ahead.
Children come. Let the children come. Time to hear the children's scripture.
Today's Bible verse is from Isaiah chapter 41, verse 13. Do not fear, I will help you.
Oh, are any of you ever afraid? Huh? I mean, we had Halloween. Did anybody get afraid at some of those costumes? I had some scary costumes come to my house. Yeah. This one girl, for instance, she had a costume on. She came up to my door, and she was wearing all black. You couldn't see any face. You couldn't see any mask. And she had a really funny little hat on, you know, that you could see. But the rest of her was all black. And I couldn't see anything. I couldn't see any eyes. I couldn't see any mouth. I couldn't see any nose. I said, well, what are you? She said, I'm a shadow. I thought that was pretty cool. Yeah, what kind of costumes? Anybody wearing costumes? What kind of costumes did you wear?
Minion.
An Indian? Oh, a minion. Oh, one of those. Uh-huh. Did you? And what about you? Say again. A tiger? And what were you? Say it real loud.
I was not a tiger.
Okay.
I was not a tiger.
One more. What are you? What were you?
I was going to be a minion.
He was going to be a minion too? Well, let you know, some of these costumes were scary that I saw. You know, people came up and they had these funny looking things on their face like they were, You don't get to see the faces, I think. And, you know, you look at them. And you had fun with it, too, didn't you? Well, you know... Oh. You did? Well, good for you. You know, sometimes, I mean, those are just fun, scary things. But sometimes scary things do happen. Have you? What kind of scary... You know, there's kinds of scary things can happen. Hey, Mom, what? Okay, Spider-Man costume. Cool. He's trying to figure out what it was. Sometimes we get scared, you know, and what the Bible verse, the kids' Bible verse was about was that if we ever get scared, that do not fear because God will help you. There are times when we do get scared, you know, but it's not maybe not costumes or things like that. You know, we do Halloween because it's fun. We get candy and all that kind of stuff. And enjoy it now while you can, because when you get my age, you can't eat it. So, but anyway, sometimes we get scared. And the message from that Bible verse is, whenever you're scared, think about how God will help you. God will always be with you. Okay? So don't be afraid. God will help you. Let's pray. Am I God? No, I'm not God. No, I'm not God. But I know God. Yeah, I'm not God. I'm Reverend Bray. I help God. That's what I do. He's there. He's here. He's among us everywhere. We can't see him. We can't see him. Way up there. In another place, but then he's here also too with us. Yeah. Yeah, I know. But I'm sorry to tell you, I'm not God, but yeah, you push that button and it works. Will you pray with me? Let's bow our heads. God, thank you for our kids, and thank you for their questions, and thank you for their lives. We really appreciate them. They're a blessing to us. Watch over them, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you.
Thank you.
Before I read the scripture reading, I will tell you a story about that, about being God. Little guy whose dad, I remember what his dad did for a living because he worked for the IRS. He was an Internal Revenue Service agent in the church I was serving at the time, and this was back about 1976. And it was a long church with a center aisle, and they would always sit in the very last row. And one day he informed his dad, he said, "I want to sit up front." And his dad said, "Oh, you don't need to do that, we're fine." He said, "No, I want to sit up front where I can see God." His dad said, "Well, he's not God." "Oh, yes, he is." "No, he's not." "Well, I still want to sit up front." So the next Sunday, they sat up front. And they sat up front for a number of weeks, and then the association minister shows up. And those of you that are not acquainted with him, when I say association minister, like bishop in the other churches, you know. The association minister shows up, and he has this gold brocade robe on. I'm wearing my little black robe, you know, and he's got this gold brocade robe on. And he's standing up there, little boy, in the middle of the service, everybody could hear him. "I get it." He pointed at the association and says, "He's God." And he pointed at him and said, "And he's Jesus Christ." From the book of Revelation, someday I'll write a book about stuff like that. Maybe. The book of Revelation, chapter 21. Often people are afraid of the book of Revelation, wonder what it's all about. It's nothing to be afraid of. "Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. And I saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, 'Behold, the dwelling place of God is with man. He will dwell with them, and they will be his people, and God himself will be with them as their God. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes, and death shall be no more. Neither shall there be mourning, nor pain, nor crying any more, for the former things have passed away.' And he who was seated on the throne said, 'Behold, I'm making all things new.' Also he said, 'Write this down, for these words are trustworthy and true.' And he said, 'It is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end.'" Turn your eyes. I want to share with you, if you happen to be looking around for a few people, that there were 45 people at our first 8 a.m. service. So if you're wondering where they are, they were probably there. "Behold, I am making all things new." With God, there will always be new beginnings. There is evidence of that throughout all of creation. The flowers fade, the leaves fall, the grass withers, only to emerge from the winter snow, renewed and fresh to live again. Even throughout the cosmos, newness exists everywhere. New stars come into being all the time. Out of areas in space where astronomers found nothing, suddenly will come to view a whole new system of stars, maybe even planets. Newness is an ever constant possibility throughout all of God's creation. If one were to consider the evolution of the Earth itself, even our planet has been renewed many times over. New kinds of life are still being discovered, even as we are still trying to understand old and extinct kinds of life. I often wonder, you know, what was God thinking when he created the dinosaur? What was that all about? I recently read that if time were compared to a roll of bathroom tissue, and this morning Marcia was in the service, so I had to point her out, you know. But if all of time was compared to a roll of bathroom tissue and completely rolled out full length along a sidewalk, the amount of time that human beings have existed in the grand scheme of things would barely equal, now get this, on that whole roll of tissue, 1 millimeter of bathroom tissue. 1 millimeter of that whole roll. We are one of the newest creations that God made in all that exists. John, while on the island of Patmos, had a very vivid vision, which he wrote down for all time and for all people to try to understand. And after going through a great detail that has been debated for the last 2,000 years about the end of time, he finally gives us God's summation of it all. The key statement in this whole reading is, "Behold, I am making all things new." Now that statement instantly raises a few questions in my mind. What does this mean? I'm making all things new. When will this happen? Can we have a sense of some of that newness about which God has spoken in our present life? Is that possible? Well, what does it mean for God to say, "I'm making all things new"? Well, this is not the first time in Judeo-Christian scripture that God has made that statement. Isaiah, the Hebrew prophet, wrote 700 years before Jesus said that, before Jesus was on the earth, that God had said, "For behold, I create new heavens and a new earth, and the former things shall not be remembered or come to mind." Earlier in Isaiah's text, there's a reference to which we often refer during Advent and Christmas season, where God said, foreshadowing the coming of Jesus Christ into the world, God said, "Behold, I am doing a new thing. Now it springs forth. Do you not perceive it?" I think all of this is a statement about the creative nature of God, a nature that is always looking for solutions that will help lead an imperfect creation toward the state of perfection and toward a oneness with our Creator. In other words, God is always opening doors through which you and I may move toward a more perfect state of being. So when God has said in that final hour of time, "Behold, I am making all things new," I am making all things new, as one commenting on this passage wrote, there is beauty beyond the powers of speech. There is ceaseless thought luminous with beauty. There is ceaseless action suffused with meaning that God himself makes possible. Obedience is free felicity, free loyalty. And then he goes on to say, there is a new integration of time and eternity in which God's will is indeed our peace. God's will becomes our peace. That's what God wants for us, all of us. And that's what it means when God says, "Behold, I'm making all things new." When, however, will it occur that all things will be new? Well, no one can know for sure, certainly not mere human beings. And in a sense, time comes to an end every day for everyone who passes away. And that great cataclysmic moment, though, when life on planet Earth, as all of us know it, is actually a time when it ends, that moment is beyond the reach of our imagination. Look at the book of Revelation. We want to talk about it. We want to ask about it. We want to think about it. But certainly those who spend their lives trying to second-guess God about that time might as well try and catch the wind. We do not know when the end of time will come. Even Jesus told his disciples, "Heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will not pass away. But concerning that day and concerning that hour, no one knows, not even the angels in heaven, nor the Son, but the Father only." Jesus had no idea. And yet, the promise from God stands in both our Old Testament and our New Testament that that day will still come, even though Jesus doesn't even know when it will happen. Since, therefore, not even Jesus knows the day or the hour, then the best advice you and I can take is just to be ready, to live as if today will be the day. That's what we have to do. Live each day that way. Learn to love. Learn to be kind. Learn to be the kind of people who follow what Jesus has taught. Because we never know which day will be the end of our lives or when it will come. Now, this brings us to the third question that came to mind. And that is, can we at least enjoy a sense of this newness that God is promising, this newness that's off into the future? Can we enjoy a little bit of it right now? And the short answer to that question is yes. Then how can that be? Well, the Apostle Paul made it very clear in his second letter to the Corinthian church that we can enjoy it. And Paul told them this. He said, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. If anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old has passed away. Behold, the new has come. So if you and I are living our lives based in Jesus' teachings and believing in him as the Son of God, then we become able to experience a newness in life. It's what I have told you before, talked about it before. It's a transformation that occurs in the follower's life that allows her or him to become a new person as if being born again. It is adapting and adopting this transformation, this transformative lifestyle, not just belief itself, not just saying I believe, but actually living it, that allows a person to experience newness of life in the here and now. And of course, it's nothing like we will experience in eternity. It is, though, for sure, something that beats the alternative that the world offers. Much more. So yes, with God, there always will be new beginnings, and in time, there will be one great big new beginning for all who are in Christ. What it means is there will be an eternity in which God's will is our peace. When the final event will happen, only God the Father knows. So we should live each day as if today is the end of time, prepared for Christ's return. And can we at least experience a little of this newness that God promises in the here and now? Yes, of course we can, by believing in Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior and following his teachings. We live a faith of promise. We live a faith of hope. No matter what we face, no matter what problems come our way. I've always taught that God is the God of second chances. Our Creator never has and never will give up on us. Our Creator never has and never will give up on you, nor me. God continues to open new doors and present new opportunities for us in our daily lives. With God, thank God, you and I can always have a new beginning. You and I can always experience the transformative newness every day of our lives. Behold, God makes all things new. God can make you new too. God can help you through whatever it is that you face. God can help you overcome the struggle that you have about something in your life. God can help you turn your back on a thing you know is taking you downhill. God can help you get through and be renewed and strengthened and be a child of God that you need to be. That's what God is saying. Behold, I make everything new. You, me, the world, everything. God has made that promise for all of us. Amen. Would you pray with me? God, our Creator, we are grateful for the presence of your Spirit here. We're grateful for how you work with each one of us, how you live in our lives, and how you help us. And even though the message is hard to hear today because of other things going on, we know, God, that in that newness of life that you promise, we can find strength and wholeness and wellness. Bless us each one here, we pray. Bless the ones who are not able to be here with us this morning. Bless those who are off in a bed or in a wheelchair and watching us on television. Bless them and help them to know you're with them. Be near those who are traveling away from us. We pray for the one whom we've just sent to the hospital. Be close to him. Help him, we pray, and help us as we pray for him. And we ask God for the nearness of your Spirit to walk with us every day of our lives. We want to be the church that you've called us to be. We want to be the people you've called us to be. And so, God, lead us and guide us in the directions that we need to go to be helpful. We ask, God, that you'd watch over us in the name of the one, our Savior, Jesus the Christ, who taught us that we may pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Serve God by giving the best that you're able to give, and know that God receives that gifts, those gifts, and blesses you for them. Bring what you have to offer, and God will bless you. God, we thank you that we're able to bring before you these gifts. We're thankful that you are here with us in the midst of struggle, in the midst of concerns, in the midst of joy and pain and sorrow. And Lord, that you've touched us in many ways that we're not aware of. So please receive what we bring this morning to use to your service and to bless you. Give our people who make the decisions intelligence and guidance and direction in the way that they should go and the things that they should do for our church. And may the gifts that we bring here prosper, and may they glorify you, our Creator, and bless you in many, many ways. We thank you for the opportunity to give, for it does do our hearts good. And we pray in Jesus' name.
Thank you.
Today is All Saints Day, and today we remember the folk who have left us and gone on to eternity. But All Saints Day, though it celebrates those who have passed on, doesn't necessarily celebrate the fact that the saints are still here. When I look out over you, I'm looking at the saints. All of us are the saints of God. All of us are the ones who are called to do God's work and do the saintly thing of sharing God's love with others and to share the joy of serving Jesus Christ as our Savior. And so, saints, as I look at you, go and be the people of God. Share the faith. Share the love and the understanding. Be faith-filled. Be glory-filled. Be folk who care about others. And even though there's us here who we are, whom we are, and there's them out there, using bad grammar, them are also the children of God. Go and serve God in love, and God will love you for it. And those of you who want communion, I'll remain for a while to give you communion. Bless God with your love. Go serve God in peace, and God's face will shine on you, and God will grant you enormous peace. Amen.